Okay. Okay, so hello everyone, and welcome to Art in Conversation Extra Talks. Today we will talk about empathy and the cinematic experience. Cinematic language evolved to affect our emotions. For example, we feel emotional while watching movies, we empathize with our movie characters, even though we know they're fictional. So what are the philosophical and psychological mechanisms underlying these effects? As usual, we invited two experts to discuss this topic from different points of view. So I'd like to remind you that first we'll have the two talks and then we'll open the discussion. So during the discussion, everyone will have the chance to ask a question or comment something. So please write down and bear in mind your questions. Now I would like to introduce our first speaker, who is Murray Smith, who is a professor of philosophy, art and film at the University of Kent. He's also the director of the Aesthetics Research Center and Divisional Deputy Director of Research and Innovation. Professor Smith is interested in film theory broadly, and his research focuses on the intersection between film, cognitive science, art, and philosophy, in particular, the philosophy of mind. He has published a range of books and articles on the topic, including Film, Art and the Third Culture, published in 2017, and Engaging Characters, first published in 1995, whose second second revised edition is about to appear, or Oxford University Press. The book addresses the emotional response to characters in relation to both cinematic and literary fictions and study characters, not just in relation to film, but literature, classics, philosophies, music studies, and media studies. Professor Smith, thank you very much for accepting our invitation. And please feel free to share your screen whenever you're ready. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Nicole, for that very kind introduction. And thank you to you and Marina and everyone at Art in Conversation for the very kind invitation. It's a very nice format you have, I think, for this, this series. Since I know at least Beres is here, and I have at least theoretical reasons to imagine that he may have played a role as well in the invite. Thanks to Beres as well. So I've probably done my usual trick, which is to kind of put together, you know, an hour and 20 minutes of material for a 20-minute slot. So I suppose I better get going. So let me share. Let me start. It's already shared, right? So I just need to, got it.
Yes, perfect. Okay. See your presentation.
Okay, so you're seeing my title slide, yes?
Just to check.
Yes? Okay, cool. Yeah. All right. Okay, very good. Okay, so what I want to begin with is, and I'm just making a note for myself of when I've begun. So let me just jot that down. So what I want to begin with is a simple but widespread and I think fundamental distinction we need to have in mind when we're thinking about empathy. Certainly if we're thinking about empathy as it's understood and discussed in contemporary debates. And that's the distinction between sympathy and empathy. So if empathy is, or at least can be, and usually is defined as, roughly speaking, feeling with another person, so like mirroring your current states of another person. So if you encounter somebody feeling pain or fear, and you're able through some process to mimic, right, to simulate the fear or the pain that they're in, then it's you could justifiably be said to be empathizing with them. Sympathy, by contrast, is the idea of having an emotional response or disposition towards another person, but not mirroring that exact feeling, right? So you can feel a sympathy for someone without mirroring the state that they're in. I won't elaborate that idea further because it will take up time. Just quickly to add that there are, so to speak, at least two routes to the state of empathy, a sort of low-level set of processes. So in other words, these are phenomena which happen usually in a kind of non-voluntary fashion at a non-conscious level. So these are mechanisms by which we're said to pick up on the emotional states of others without really thinking about it or without really trying to. We just have these natural capacities to tune into the states of those around us. So that's what I mean by the low-level processes. On the other hand, and perhaps this is more familiar as a conception of what empathy is. We can also sort of aim at empathy in a very high level way. In other words, we can consciously aim to adopt the mindset of some other person or fictional character. Of course, that's where we're going with this talk eventually. We can do so in a very conscious, high level way. So that's a kind of an imaginative project. And this is often described as imagining from the inside. Okay. Let me just quickly note, this is a little bit of a digression, but just to quickly note how widespread the notion of empathy is in kind of ordinary discourse. So I'm not going to read this quotation here, but you can see at the top here, I've got a quotation from a very recent piece about the Ukrainian conflict and a claim that Zelensky has a very self-conscious strategy to use a kind, to use empathy to make a kind of connection with distant audiences that he's trying to appeal to. And we can also see roughly the same thing happening, for example, in the still fairly recent American presidential election, where Biden was widely praised and characterized as a particularly empathic presidential candidate, which may not have been such a big achievement relative to his opponent. Nonetheless, it was something that was said of Biden and said to be an important part of his eventual success. So all of that, I think, connects with a very widespread assumption, an assumption both in everyday discourse and in theoretical discourse, that empathy as a particular kind of capacity or skill, a kind of mental skill, plays a distinctive and some would say essential skill in respect of moral psychology. Now, that's a claim that I'm going to go on to question, or at least raise a question about towards the end of the talk if I have time. But I just note here that that is a very widespread assumption. A little bit of history. Again, I won't dwell on this for long in order to preserve time. But the main point here is that although the term empathy is quite a recent one, so it's first coined in German in the 1870s and then gets translated into English in the early 20th century. So it's a term, and the term in German is Einfühlung, as you can see here on the slide, literally in feeling. The idea is something that we see in much earlier writing. So famously, for example, Adam Smith and David Hume both describe what we would now think of as empathy, although they would use the word sympathy, or sympathy would be one of the terms that they used to refer to this idea. So I've got one phrase there from Hume, which I quote. Hume says at one point, "The minds of men are mirrors to one another." Okay, so that's a kind of general characterization of at least an aspect of human cognition. And I thought it was apt to mention that quotation because of the contemporary significance of the discovery of so-called mirror neurons. So many of you will be familiar with this. Again, I won't dwell on it too long. But the idea of mirror neurons is that these are neurons which are said to be active both when we behave in certain ways. So, for example, when we adopt certain expressions or make certain movements. And additionally, these particular neurons also fire, they're active when we witness those same expressions or those same movements. So you can see how it's not surprising, especially bearing in mind the way in which empathy and kindred notions have been described historically, that the mirror neuron literature has been embraced as a kind of new kind of evidence in support of the reality of empathy as a kind of psychological state. Now, this is a kind of this is a new thing, or at least it's a new phrase that I'm throwing into the talk today. So, empathic incontinence. What on earth might I mean by that? Well, remember I was saying a few minutes ago that one route to empathy is through these kind of low-level processes, things like emotional contagion, affective mimicry. I know I haven't defined these in any detail, but what they share is the idea that these are involuntary mechanisms that are part of our sort of underlying human psychological capacities. And what they do is they enable us to tune in, right, to the cognitive and emotional states of those around us. Now, that being the case, there is a sort of interesting problem to think about, which is if we have these mechanisms and they work in that way, how are they regulated? By which I mean, how is it the case that we're not subject to, as it were, a disordered explosion of noise from those around us, right? In other words, if these mechanisms were not regulated somehow, we'd be tuning in to the states of so many others around us, it would be kind of chaotic for us. So just as with our perceptual skills, there are ways in which our perception is tuned so that we don't pick up everything all of the time in a disordered fashion. So it is the case with empathy. So how does this work? Well, roughly speaking, empathy, in other words, those we empathize with, is structured by two things, I think, in, as it were, real social interaction. First of all, we empathize with those, or we're more likely to empathize with those we're proximate with, physically close to, in certain ways. And secondly, we're more likely to empathize with those with whom we share interests and values, who we're sympathetic to, disposed to favor, and so forth. Now, if we think about those two principles in relation to film, this takes us to the model that I develop. I'm guessing maybe some of you will know about this model. So here's the second edition, which is due out within a couple of weeks. Now, the three terms I put on the left, those are kind of the three kind of like central concepts in the book by which I argue that our responses to fictional characters are shaped. But the two that I want to emphasize today are alignment and allegiance. And I'm going to come at this basically through an example, which I'm going to show you in just a second. But I will, cut to the example now. So let me see. I'm going to have to stop sharing this slideshow. Right. Am I out of that now? Yes. Okay. Right. Let me bring it up. Okay. Right. Just give me a sec here. Come on. Sorry, I've just got to resize the screen so I can make it manageable. Right. Okay. Now, I should have framed the quick reference to the forthcoming second edition of my book with a shameless self-promotion alert. Now we have a different kind of alert. We have a spoiler alert because the clip I'm going to show you, I was sort of wrestling with what clip to show people. And I decided I wanted to go with something very contemporary, something that was going to be new and fresh for people rather than something, possibly hoary and old. So I'm going to show you a clip from Drive My Car, right? So the Japanese film, which got a lot of attention in recent months. Very interesting film, I think. And it is a little way into the film. So you haven't seen it, too bad. Shut your eyes and ears now. There's nothing I can do about it. The die is cast. This is the clip I've chosen. Now, do I need to tell? Yeah, I need to tell you a little bit about just a little bit of narrative setup here. So this is about 10 or 15 minutes into the film. The film at this point is about a couple. The man in the couple is a theater director, and he's what we're seeing at the beginning of the clip. He's leaving to go off to a festival, a theater festival in a different city. So we're seeing him park his car, just about to take a flight. Then I'm going to let the action run for 3 minutes. All you need to know by way of further context is that up to this point in the film, everything we've seen about this couple suggests that they're a totally solid, loving couple. Okay, so here we go with the clip. Right, are we seeing the movie screen? Yes. Right, so I'm going to run it and then I'm going to bump it up to full size. You're hearing the sound?
Yes.
Okay. Full screen?
Yes. Okay, I think we've seen enough. Sorry about, were you seeing all of that garbage around the edge of the image, kind of like my icons and stuff, yes? Or was that visible? No?
No, oh.
Okay, that's good news. All right, I think what I'll do is I'm just going to exit this. Have I come out of it now? Yeah, we're no longer sharing. Right, so, sorry, let's get rid of. Okay, so let me just say a little bit about what I had in mind in picking that clip. So the basic idea is, and this is what I'm about to describe, is what I call alignment, right? Is that the film is structured so that we're following the male character, right? As he drives back from the airport. So we're following his actions and his reactions as he comes back from the airport and makes this shocking discovery. Well, in fact, it turns out later in the film that it's not that shocking, which might explain subsequently why he reacts in the way he does. Nonetheless, to come back to the basic point is we're following his path of action and his reactions, right? So at this point of the film, at least, this is very much his story. Now, the end point of that process of being aligned with this particular character is to generate empathy with this character. Now, this is a slightly perverse choice I've made in using this sequence, because actually it's a sequence which kind of holds off a little bit. You can certainly imagine, right, the same sequence being shot in a somewhat different way to emphasize more full-bloodedly, right, and more clearly, transparently, the reactions of the character. But in a way, that's what I wanted to demonstrate, that empathy you know, is perhaps not best thought of as a simple on-off switch, right? But it's a matter of degree, right? So the process of alignment can be structured to take us, you know, very intimately into the states of a character, or it can keep us at a great distance, or it can be somewhere intermediate. And this particular sequence is sort of somewhat intermediate. So to give one particular example of what I mean, you'll have noticed that this one shot, reaction shot of his face, where he's taking in the fact that his wife, you know, is making love to this younger guy. But we're seeing that reaction reflected in a mirror. Now, we do see his face quite clearly, but the fact that we're seeing it in a mirror adds a little bit of a layer, right, of mediation to our response to him and our ability to pick up what he's thinking. And of course, as you'll have noticed, he's not very expressive, right? So his reaction is pretty muted, and we don't at this point in the film quite know what to make of his reaction. Okay, so let me come back to my slideshow, and I believe that I've already taken 18 minutes, so I'm going to absolutely rip through our last few points, including saying a little bit more about the sequence we've just seen. I did warn you that I had way too much material. Okay, here we go. So back to the slideshow. Okay, we're seeing it again, yeah?
Yes,
good. Yeah. Okay, very good. Okay, so just very quickly, that's the diagram in the middle of the book, which summarizes, you know, the whole nine yards. So if I were to try and kind of describe to you every nuance about the way empathy and sympathy interact with one another in relation to fictional characters, that's the diagram that I'd have to set you through, but that's not going to happen now. So all I really want to end by talking about are a couple of related points, which, as I say, will take us back to the sequence I've just shown you. So I think it's fair to say that in the sort of cutting edge of debate around empathy, both as a general psychological phenomenon, but also in particular in the way empathy works in films, there's a sort of emphasis on the limits of empathy. In other words, how much weight we should put on empathy as a way of understanding how it is we relate to others, real others and fictional characters, and what, so to speak, we can reasonably expect of empathy. And this plays out in respect of two, at least these two things. There are limits with respect to what empathy delivers in the way of understanding others, and there are limits with respect to how empathy works in our moral responsibility to others. So if I just quickly say one or two things about both of those points. So in relation to understanding others, the thought is this. I'll leave the slide there, but I'm just going to use the clip as a way of explaining this point. So I've already, I hope, kind of established the idea that the film is structured at that point. So we're following him, we're aligned with him, we're following his movements, actions, and reactions. But even so, we can't understand everything about what he's going through, right? So we can't understand quite the nature of his response to the discovery of his wife having sex with another man. Now, one part of that lack of complete understanding simply has to do with the limits of empathy. No matter how potent our mimicking of his state of shock in that particular scene, we wouldn't really have a full understanding of it until we've got more context about the nature of this relationship, the history of the relationship, and what the consequences of this incident might be. And that, of course, is what happens if you know the film, or even if you don't know the film, you can guess. This is the kind of further understanding of a character's state of mind which unfolds across the rest of the film. So as it turns out, and here I guess I will limit what I say because I don't want to make the spoiler too disastrous, you know, we learn that there are reasons why, right? His reaction in the discovery scene are more muted and more complex than we might expect them to be when they first occur, right? So the basic idea here is no matter how potent
this empathic reaction might be, where, once again, this is the idea of empathy as the mimicking of the occurrent state, right? The felt experience of another in a particular moment. That's never going to give the whole picture, right? Because you always need further context in order to understand the meaning of that state of mind in its fullness. So the other limitation of empathy that's been heavily discussed over the roughly the past decade is in respect of its relationship with morality. And the idea here is to challenge that widespread assumption that I noted at the outset of the talk, which is that empathy is often taken to be a crucial and sometimes the crucial ingredient of having a strong moral disposition and sense of moral sensitivity towards others. And again, with time in mind, just to quickly summarize what the idea is, the critical idea is that on its own, empathy can actually mislead us. For example, because we're very prone to empathizing, as I said earlier in the talk, with those who are proximate to us, in contrast to those who are more remote from us. And that can be a problem in certain contexts, right? So the idea is putting too much weight on empathy as a kind of component of our overall moral skill set, shall we say, is a mistake. It's a mistake both in terms of how morality in its fullness does work, and perhaps even more importantly, it's a mistake in terms of how we think morality should work in an ideal way. Last slide. So what I really want to kind of emphasize at the more ambitious end of this talk, aside from giving you some sense of what empathy is in basic terms, is the idea that films and film sequences typically elicit a mosaic of varied responses, interweaving in empathy and sympathy. I think it's a mistake to kind of think that empathy is ever operating kind of in isolation from other things. That doesn't mean to say we can't distinguish it, right, from other kinds of response, which is where I began this talk. But in practice, it doesn't work alone, usually. And as I say, from a moral point of view and from the point of view of understanding others, it's a good thing that it doesn't work entirely alone because of those limitations in respect of both understanding and morality that I was speaking about. And with that, I will pause because I have definitely gone over time. So thank you.
It is okay. Thank you very much, Professor Smith, for such an interesting presentation. I'm sure everyone will have a lot of comments and questions which you can ask during the discussion. And we are going to our next speaker. It's Katalin Balint, who is an associate professor at the Faculty of Social Sciences at Vrije Universiteit Amsterdam. So she researches viewer psychological responses to audiovisual media and narratives. Dr. Balint conducts empirical studies into how formal features such as short scale, cut rate, gaze behavior of characters influence empathy, theory of mind, and narrative engagement in viewers. So Dr. Balint was awarded a 3-year individual research grant by the German Science Foundation. Her project investigates the role of audiovisual formal features in eliciting empathy and prosocial behaviors in film viewers. So Dr. Balint, thank you very much for accepting our invitation, and we very much look forward for your talk. So please feel free to share your screen whenever you're ready.
Thank you very much. Can you see it?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, perfect. Thank you very much for the kind invitation. Well, I prepared an introduction slide, but you already told a lot about me, maybe a bit about my background, because I studied psychology as well as film and media studies, and I did 2 postdocs in communication science. So I have a mixed background, but in the past 5 years, I'm situated at the communication science department, which really shapes how I think about narratives and empathy in specific. And I took the liberty that I will talk about the perspective of communication science on empathy, which is very different from the humanities perspective, as you will see. I will talk about empathy in the second part of my talk, so please bear with me, but I will give the broader context of communication science. So one of the big fields in communication science is the study of persuasion, asking the question how mediated messages may influence people's attitude, intentions, worldview, behavior in the widest sense. And in the past 20 years, there has been a growing body of findings and studies showing that the persuasive effects of narratives are larger compared to non-narrative messages, for example, the list of statistical facts. And there are a lot of meta-analytic papers which are collecting the statistical effect sizes of a lot of studies proving this larger effect. And that led to the narrative turn in persuasion studies, and the term narrative persuasion was coined, which refers to a story consistent change in the individual's beliefs, attitudes, intentions, virtue as a result of having seen or having read a narrative. And a big development of this area is that scholars started to think of the underlying mechanisms, the best predictors of these narrative effects. Basically, the question is what happens between a narrative exposure that I watched the movie, I read a novel, and the effects that it has on me. What happens between, in the black box between the two? And one of the first and most popular narrative persuasion theories, the transportation imagery model, claims that the best predictor of narrative persuasion is the mental state of the individual during watching or reading a narrative. So we have to look into the mind of the person. And they coined the term narrative transportation, which is a unique mental state describing this very unique altered state of mind that takes place during a narrative exposure. There are other related terms you might have read about, for example, narrative engagement or narrative absorption, flow, also a related term, which tries to capture what happens to the reader or the viewer or the gamer during narrative. So what is narrative transportation? It's a unique state of mind during which the individual invests all their emotional and cognitive capacity into the story, becomes very much concentrated on the story events, the integrative melding of attention, imagery, and feelings, as Green and Brock originally described it. And what the theory says about the relation of narrative transportation and narrative effects, that basically when we are transported into a story world, let it be fictional or non-fictional, basically all our cognitive capacity is busy with understanding the narratives. So we have less capacity to actually check the information that is presented to us. We don't think about the credibility of the information, which leads to reduced reactance, reduced counter-arguing, and we just simply believe what we have seen or watched or listened to. And the next question came, how to measure narrative transportation? And that was one of the questions from the organizers, what kind of measures we use in this field, there are a lot of self-report scales already validated, the narrative transportation scale, short form of the same scale, narrative engagement scale, narrative absorption scale. So it's these are validated scales that can reliably capture the intensity of the narrative transportation experience. Later, Bizel and Bilancic came up with the theory of narrative engagement and the improvement compared to the narrative transportation theory was that they realized that this narrative engagement experience is not a unidimensional experience, but it has different components that we can identify. And on the slide, you see the four different components that they found in their studies. First is focused attention. The second is character engagement. The third is narrative comprehension. And the fourth is narrative presence. So the individual invests their cognitive capacity to the stories through which they start to pay attention to the characters' mental states and the journey of the character. Through character engagement, they understand the meaning of the story and the structure of the story. And through these processes, they feel that they are in the story, in the physical space of the fictional story world. So what is important for us today that communication science sees character engagement as one component of the narrative engagement experience that interacts with attention, comprehension, and narrative presence. One of the nice things about the narrative engagement scale, which has these four dimensions, that Bilancic and her research team made a huge effort to ground their self-report scale in the psychophysiological measures. And in this study that I quote here, they could show that attentional focus was related to heart rate, emotional engagement was related to corrugator activity, and both attentional focus and emotional engagement was related to skin conductance. So what people report in the scale could be also captured at a physiological, a less conscious level. So let me talk a bit about character engagement as a component of narrative engagement. Research found that character engagement, so the subdimension, is the best predictor of persuasion. So when people engaged with the character, it's very likely that they don't start to counter-argue with the content of the message. What I want to stress that this is an umbrella term, referring to various ways how people relate to characters, and on the next slide I will list a few of the terms that relates to character engagement. And that is a big difference compared to film studies. In film studies, when we talk about character engagement, most of the time we mention empathy and sympathy. These are the two processes through which we imagine people relate to characters. In communication science, there is a garden variety of character engagement types. Parasocial interaction, which is the sense of having a conversation with the character during the narrative. Parasocial relationship, which is a sense of having an imaginary friendship with the character after the narrative. Perceived similarity, when I think about the shared features with the character. Visual identification, I would like to be similar to the character. Identification, which is a kind of merging of the self and the character in terms of motivations. And also state empathy, which is the understanding and sharing of mental states. Interestingly, sympathy is not discussed in communication science. Sometimes empathy concern is mentioned, but for some reason, communication science is not interested in sympathy in itself as a process. And as you see, state empathy is a very specific, very narrow concept of character engagement within this very different broad categories. Empathy looks like a very specific process, but it is still important, and there is theory about state empathy in communication science, and I refer to Shen, who developed a scale and also based on a grounded psychological work, Desity and Jackson's work, she presented the components of empathy, theorizing empathy as a message processing activity, as opposed to empathy as a personality trait. And she identified three components, very much relatable to comparable to what Marie just said: a cognitive component, which is the perspective taking, recognizing, comprehending, and adopting another person's point of view; affective empathy, which is the activation and experience of affective reactions to others' experiences and expressions of emotions. So this is sharing of the emotional state of the character. And there is a third component, which is not mentioned in the film studies literature, as far as I know. But according to Shen, state associative empathy, which refers to identification, in short, a mechanism through which audience members experience reception and interpretation of the message from the inside. So that's like the operation of the mirror neurons and emotional contagion in the film studies literature. You see here it's distinguished from affective empathy. And I wanted to show you the scale validated by Shen. It's interesting to see how they want to capture affective empathy, cognitive empathy, and associative empathy. You see that for affective empathy, it's about same emotions, similar emotional state. I feel the character's emotions. For cognitive empathy, the items refer to seeing, recognizing, understanding, that the situation is understandable. And for associative empathy, it's about absorption, relation, identification. So something like self-character merging. And if we look at the studies that use fictional narratives and neuropsychological measures, we see that the same distinction comes up, that there is an automatic embedded simulation process through which we involuntarily share emotions, and there is a more cognitive theory of mind-related process that facilitates, supports the understanding of mental states in others. If you're interested in the neuropsychological underpinnings, I highly recommend Gal Raz's work, who is the first author of this paper. He's a film director and neuropsychologist, so it's a very interesting mixed background again, and he does wonderful work on this topic. Okay, summary of my talk. So in communication science, we differentiate narrative features and effects, and we are very much interested in the mediating processes of narrative experience, and narrative transportation is the the higher order category within which we identify different components. Character engagement is one of them. And within character engagement, one component is state empathy, besides many other character engagement processes, which makes the picture much more colorful and interesting to research. So this was it. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for this interesting talk. Thank you. So it is time now for the discussion. And during the discussion, we traditionally begin it with two of our speakers commenting on each other talks. So if you have any question or comment on each other talks, I invite you to maybe Professor Smith goes first. Thank you.
Okay. Sure. Well, I have lots of questions for you. For you, Katalin, but I'll just throw out a couple, yeah, and then you can throw some rotten fruit at me in reply. This is a very minor thing, but just to pick up, you know, a terminological question, really. When you refer to empathy, at least in the second part of the talk, you make a point of calling it state empathy. Now, is that to mark the fact that, as it were, there are other references to empathy in the communications literature which refer to empathy as a process rather than the state or something? Why state empathy?
No, the differentiation refers to state versus trait.
State versus trait.
Trait empathy as a steady personality feature. Got and it. State empathy that what you actually right. do during.
Got it.
Okay. Yeah.
So here's another question. Sorry, I'm just trying to decide which of two or three to ask. In terms of empathy as a kind of predictor for persuasive effect, I suppose there are two parts of this question. One is, I'm guessing, and you can tell me if this is right, that when you say character engagement is a predictor of persuasion, what you mean by character engagement is something like what I would call conventional character engagement, because it's kind of part of my overall argument is that character engagement can take the form of many different things, right? So by conventional character engagement, I mean something like a central character who's clearly identifiable, who has appealing, you know, who is admirable, largely admirable and appealing, who has identifiable goals, which are partially achieved, right? So we have a conventional kind of narrative experience around a somewhat conventional character. Now, for me, it would still be character engagement if it's, I don't know, just to pluck an example from the air, like a film like Naked by Mike Lee, where you've got a very troubling, anti-heroic, rather unpleasant character. Nonetheless, that's character engagement from my point of view, but I'm guessing that the literature you're referring to is not thinking of, you know, it has something more specific in mind when it talks about the correlation between character engagement and persuasive effect. Did that question make sense?
If I understand your question, whether whether the engagement itself is positively balanced or negatively balanced.
That would be a perfectly good sort of concise way of expressing the point.
Because you could still like a troubled character, so you could still have a positive relationship to a troubled character, right? So it's
absolutely. I mean, the larger point I'm making is character engagement kind of like, you know, has a million different instances.
Yeah, you can hate a character and that's still engagement.
Exactly. Yeah. And I'm guessing that when the claim is made from the research you're referring to that there's a strong relationship between character engagement and persuasion, that it's a subset of particular kinds of character engagement that are being
it's a positive relationship for sure. At least the skills that are used cannot measure a negative relationship. So it's like excluded from the moral engagement and moral disengagement is a big field in communication science, and there are different skills, so it's like kept separately method wise.
I see. Right, got it. Okay, well, look, I have other questions, but I'm thinking, you know, if I let Katalin ask me a question or two, and then I'm sure both of us can come back to other questions we might have during the open discussion.
Yeah. Thank you. So, Dr. Balint, do you have any questions for Professor Smith about his presentation?
Yeah. I have two questions. I will start with the more interesting one, I think. It's when you showed this film scene and the viewer didn't get a lot of information of what's going on in the character's head. And that's, if I understood well, you said that that's why empathy is limited at this point, because we don't get the full context of the operation of this relationship. And I was wondering, because I think it's more in psychology where they differentiate empathy and empathic accuracy. Mm-hmm. So you can still like imagine right. A lot of things, it will not be accurate,
sure,
but it's still empathy. So I was wondering, like, is it limited or it's just like inaccurate?
Well, I guess I would want to say of this particular example, right, and similar examples, that it's not merely that we're thrown back on empathizing, which may not be accurate, but that we're quite deliberately kind of like left to kind of struggle, right? So there are lots of things beyond the things that I mentioned in the brief discussion. So I mean, most of the framings are quite distant, right? So we get very few close-ups, we get very little in the way of vocal expression. Right. So that's another channel of communication. So there's no, he doesn't say anything. He doesn't mutter anything. He doesn't utter little cries of pain, or at least we're not given access to any vocal expressions, very few gestures. I it's no denial whatsoever that, as it were, indeed, I think you and I would agree that the space that the film leaves is exactly the space where those low-level sort of affective process, that's the void into which they run, right? It's kind of like, what's going on with this character, right? You know?
Yeah, that relates very much to my next question, because what might happen to the viewer is, I think it's not the low level, because I think like a crying close-up, a close-up of a crying face would elicit the low level. I think what happens to the viewer is like, okay, how would I feel? Right. Like, I think it invites memory.
Sure.
That how did I feel in similar situations when I was cheated on, or how?
Right.
It's like,
right.
And recently I got very interested in the relationship between empathy and autobiographical memory. So that's why I really liked this illustration, that I think when the movie or the director doesn't share a lot of information, you have to fill in the gaps. Like,
I completely take your point, actually. That as it were, the director, if it wanted to kind of trigger those low-level responses, would have put the film together in a very different way.
Yeah.
Nonetheless, I guess as a kind of theoretical point, I would want to say that I don't think of kind of the high level, the kind of theory of mind type activity, and the low level automatic responses, they're not mutually exclusive, right?
No.
So I think that normally speaking, as it were, in actual interaction and in relation to movies and mediated objects, both processes are going to be at play, and the design of the given film will kind of have a large say in determining how those things come together. But I certainly agree with you, you know, that in this case, the sort of careful and somewhat remote, emotionally remote kind of framing and depiction of the character does force us more onto the kind of theory of mind and you've made an interesting point about how we might draw on memory as well, which is yet another overlapping mechanism, I guess. Maybe that will be a good moment to. Is that okay, Katalin? I think that's.
Yeah.
We could open up and we can maybe come back to those points if questions steer us in that direction.
Thank you. So I just remind everyone that if you have a question, you can either raise your hand or write the question in the chat. Either way, I'll give you a chance to speak. So while we are waiting for people to start reacting, I have a question to Dr. Balint. So in your model, you presented as the outcome variables, persuasion effect, like change in beliefs and attitudes and behaviors. Do you mean change in beliefs and attitudes in real life? I mean, not related to the media or cinema, right? So, yes. That was my question. And then another question is, does it mean, I mean, in your presentation, you also showed us the poster of You, the Netflix series about a serial maniac, basically serial murderer. And it was widely discussed in media that in these series, they show you this serial killer from first perspective, and you watch the whole series of events where he's meeting people and murdering them from his perspective. And some people, well, me personally, when I watched it, although we know that murder is bad, nevertheless, when situation happens that this guy can be captured by the police, we kind of feel unpleasant emotions. We empathize with him. We want him to get away with it. Does it mean that if we are watching cinema, which involves negative characters, characters who do bad things, but nevertheless, we empathize with them because the series is built in a way that we perceive the events from their perspective, we empathize with them. Does it mean that it kind of changes our attitudes in the real world about what is good or bad? Does it mean that we are now more tolerant to mass murders and things like that? How does this self-identification or empathy with negative characters, not just good ones like Harry Potter, how does that affect our moral, maybe, beliefs? Thank you.
In the real life. Yeah, the first part of the question, yes, communication science is interested in real life behavior, attitude, intention, in a wide range, like from health behavior to environmental behavior to moral judgment and so on. And that's a big research question that you just asked, how engaging with morally ambiguous characters affect people's moral appreciation in real life. And the results are rather mixed, because yes, we empathize with the character in the You series, and you often reflect on this, like, why am I empathizing with a serial killer? So actually what happens, that it really activates our moral thinking. We reflect on values. We reflect on this relationship. So it can have two outcomes. Actually, we will become more conscious about our moral values, right? Or it has a biased effect. And the results show both.
That's very interesting. Just made me think about my small nephew, who's like 5 years old, and he watched this movie where the main villain was the Carnage, so it's kind of super villain. And in the movie, they show that he was bullied as a child, and my little nephew watched it and said, well, he's not that bad because he was also hurt as a child. So it's like shows the cognitive complexity he developed while watching this villain. Thank you very much. We have a question from Patrick. Patrick, do you want to ask your question?
Sure. Well, thank you both for some really intriguing talks. My question is really more for Murray Smith, and I remember watching Drive My Car with much interest, and that scene in particular was really shocking because it was and perplexing, because I found it very difficult to grasp what was going on in the head of the theatre director. So I wanted, if you might expand on, you touched on the notion of sort of subjective access to the character's state and the significance of almost opaqueness there, or sort of lack of transparency, because that can be quite generative, but it can also sort of fail because you just feel very disconnected from the character. So I wondered if you could shed some light on what's going on as a spectator when you encounter a character whose sort of motivations and responses are a bit difficult to interpret or to know.
Yeah, happy to do that. Yeah, and I mean maybe just to preface the thoughts that I'm going to come out with. I mean, I suppose I would take it that a film like this is by design, confronting us with one or more characters, right, whose psychology gradually unfolds for us, right? So part of the, you might even sort of say a little bit reductively, but not very reductively, but that is the story of the film, right? It's gradually coming to understand in its fullness, what this character's experience has been. I get, probably for some audience members, it's achingly slow, right? The way it unfolds across the film. But to come back to the scene and begin there, I mean, so you've helpfully mentioned, you've elaborated a little bit on something that I didn't really, really talk on explicitly in the talk. So when I talk about alignment, that really breaks down into two components, which are spatial attachment and subjective access, right? So spatial attachment, we definitely get, right? Because we're following him through the space of the story, right? So we're seeing him drive the car, we're seeing him come back into the apartment building, we see him unlock the door. Pretty much every shot, with maybe a single exception, and the exception is when there's a cut to the music playing, right? That doesn't seem to represent his attention or his point of view. It's not clear that it does any, but everything else seems to be kind of like following him and his attention. So we get spatial attachment very clearly. So again, imagine how the sequence could be made differently if it cross-cut between the guy driving back from the airport and cutting into the apartment where the woman is having the liaison. So that, as it were, in a kind of suspense structure, right? It's like, oh my God, and he's on his way back, right? That's not what he goes for, right? So it's structured very much around aligning us spatially with the character. And yet, and this is where you mentioned subjective access, very limited subjective access, not completely null, right? So it's not like we get nothing, right? So we are able to register the fact that you know he's a bit perplexed about his flight being cancelled, but he kind of takes it in his stride. He certainly is startled, right, when he unlocks the door and suddenly hears the moments of pleasure and the music. But beyond those reactions, everything is very contained. And I guess there's some temptation, because it's a Japanese film, right, to kind of start appealing to kind of like Japanese, what we think of in the West, right, as Japanese norms of kind of strong emotional decorum in Japanese culture. In other words, tamping down big expressions of emotion. I'm not an expert. I imagine those are cliches with some degree of actual purchase on Japanese culture, but not complete purchase, right? So if I were running a kind of more thorough exploration of the film in its cultural context, I'd be wary of reducing it to just some, oh, that's the way the Japanese are. They're not very expressive, right? I think there's something very particular going about this narrative and this film, which has to do with, as I've already said, with playing out the story of these characters in sort of slow form, right? So it's really, since you've seen the film, Patrick, at least I can say this to you, I can pretend you're the only audience member, right? I can say this to you. So it's really not until, from memory, maybe 10 or 20 minutes from the end of the film, where he has a kind of conversation with the car driver, you know, like they've gone to find her childhood home. And it's that conversation almost at the end of the film where we kind of like are able to really kind of piece together pretty much the full story, which explains fully what his wife is doing in that, like what explains the fact that she's with this young guy and what explains the nature of his reaction to it. So I'm trying to piece that thought together with what Katalin was asking me about, you know, about empathizing as a kind of, you know, activity and that empathic accuracy as a kind of goal. And what I'm saying is that, yeah, I agree that kind of like empathizing as an activity is kind of like, let's say it's a tendency that's constantly present for us because it's just a basic capacity which films can encourage or not. But it's always poised for action. This film kind of holds it, you know, it can't suppress it entirely, but it sort of holds it at bay and sort of insists on this kind of like slow motion unfolding, right, of the story. And that speaks to the kind of last part of my talk, which was the emphasis on the idea that, look, you know, no matter how vivid and intense your uptake, your feeling like, oh, this character is in pain, or this character is in distress, right? And sometimes that happens. Until you have contextual information, and often that will come in a film, right? Through the film in its entirety, a story in its entirety will give you, you know, the context, right? Then your understanding of the meaning of the current state of the character will be limited to that extent, right? Does that say enough, Patrick, or does that say something to the point?
Yeah, that's very illuminating. Thank you. Appreciate that.
Thanks. Thanks for the question.
Thank you both. We now have a question from Nicole. Nicole, can you please ask your question?
Yes, thank you very much. And my question was linked a little bit of what Professor Smith was saying about the music and how the music plays in that scene in Drive My Car. And I think perhaps more than a real question is I wanted to prompt a reflection, because perhaps that is a way in which we experience empathy with characters very differently compared to other situations in real life. So the use of music in that particular scene is telling us something about the emotional tone of the scene itself. And I'm thinking something that made me think was another way in which classical music is used in a movie, Manchester by the Sea, where actually when the main character has a very shocking news about his story, we only hear the music rather than hearing the sounds of his pain. So I thought perhaps if you, I wanted to have your thoughts about how the music is used differently, perhaps in two different cases in which we have two very strong emotional responses by the characters, but in one scene with Drive My Car, the music is coming from the environment, and also we have noises coming from the characters. And instead, when the director decides not to give us the voice of the characters, but instead overrides that with the music. And I was wondering if you can comment how the music plays, what's the role that music plays in those kind of use of music.
Yeah, Katalin, shall I say a couple of things and then do you want to? Sure. Okay. So if I just use your reference to Manchester by the Sea as a kind of like starting point, because from memory, that's a less complicated use of music, I think, to prompt a kind of empathic emotion for the character. From memory, I would say, compared with Drive My Car. So in Manchester by the Sea, I think I'm remembering the scene you're thinking of. Is it the fire? house burns down, people get killed, bad news.
I'm trying not to spoil the movie, but yes, that's the
really, really bad news, right?
Yes.
And you get like, what is it? I mean, it's very melodramatic, right? It's Samuel Barber's Adagio, right? Kind of. So it's a very piercing lament, like classical lament that we get, which conveys, yeah, intense sadness, right? Does this conform with your memory and experience?
Indeed, yes.
So now it could be that I am misremembering or inattentive to how the music was working in Drive My Car. I mean, one thing I want to say about music in Drive My Car is, you know, the title of the film, you know, for anyone who was born after, or for anyone almost, right, it's like, well, when's the Beatles song? And of course, it never comes, right? It's never in the film. So the most salient music in the clip that I showed is the classical music that's on the turntable. Did you recognize what it was? I have to say, I wasn't really. Yeah, you know, I was kind of it's classical music. You know, it's not Drive My Car. What a shame. That's the level that I was absorbing it. I mean, were you thinking, it's a question back to you, Nicole, were you thinking that the role of the music that's playing when the husband returns to the room is to kind of echo the sadness that he's feeling?
Well, I'm just claiming that, of course, it's a fiction, and therefore the music is chosen in a way to give us an instrument to interpret the emotional tone of the scene. So that was my that was my comment.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, well, I certainly agree with that as a general point, but my thought about how it's working in that scene is that, unlike in the Manchester by the Sea example, where the music is there to very directly render for us in musical form the primal emotional, you know, it's grief, I guess, is the better word for it, right, of the central character. In the Drive My Car scene, it seems to be much more like, okay, the music is there because the couple who are having, you know, having the affair are sort of, you know, they're prettifying the room, you know, you know what I'm saying? The music is there as a kind of erotic kind of like background for those two characters. So I experience the music as part of the kind of discord for the husband as he arrives, right? But as it were, you know, he's obviously, even though it's not expressed as we were saying, right? So his face doesn't break. He's very controlled in his reactions. Nonetheless, what I guess we're all sitting there thinking is, oh my God, you know, this is a shock for him. He's going to be in turmoil. And the music is a kind of ironic contrast, right? Because it's got this beautiful, placid, you know, decorum to it. That's how I think I experience it and would interpret it. What do you think, Cameron?
I can add to the broader question of the role of music in empathic responses to narrative, because that's a studied question in communication science. And yes, it's a channel of information, like just saying it simply. So that's a channel through which the director or the maker can send the message, this is what I think the character is thinking. So it's a said that it kind of adds to the axis of subjectivity in Murray's terminology, right? It gives insight. And I just wanted to talk about a recent study of mine. It's not published. We conducted it last year, where we used this animated film, Father and the Daughter, which is also about grief. You might have seen it. It's a 9-minute animation. It won the Oscar in 2001. Shows a little girl who lost her father, and she goes back repeatedly to the physical place where they said goodbye. And it's in the original version of the movie, it's the Wave of Danube. So it's a very emotional music, very much tells about the the inner life of the character, lots of emotions, lots of sadness, lots of fluctuation of emotions. And what I did in an experiment, don't hate me, I removed the music with the physical sound of the environment. So it's I found a version on YouTube. Someone created a version for this movie where you hear the wind, you hear the bicycle creaking, you hear the birds. So it's like a lot of physical sounds with no emotional tone to it. And I thought, oh, that's wonderful. I could compare the empathic effect of these two versions of the same visuals, different soundtrack. I found no differences whatsoever. so it's people empathized equally, similarly highly in both versions because the visuals were so strong and the story is so strong that actually the music couldn't add to it. It's like if I just showed it without any sounds, it just empathy goes through the roof because how it was made. So that's also, it was very interesting to me because I was convinced that the music will add a lot to the intensity. Yeah.
Can I quickly come in on that? I know that Beres has his hand up and maybe there are others too, but just quickly to build on what Katalin's just said. I mean, yeah, and Katalin, I'm not making any kind of negative remark here about, as you know, I'm fully in favor of psychological research on aesthetics. But I think that's a good example of the challenge, right, of looking for kind of general principles, right, about how, broadly speaking, aesthetic principles work. Because, well, to put it in classical terms, you know, well, the classical idea is that it's not rule-bound, right? But kind of like beauty and aesthetic achievement kind of like precisely doesn't happen through kind of like anything as simple as the adherence to a set of rules. Now, I don't think that means you can't do meaningful, systematic research on such things. But just to build on your example and to connect it with Nicole's reference to Manchester by the Sea, I mean, when I saw that film, Nicole, I was kind of horrified by that scene because I thought that the use of music was just too heavy-handed. And I just thought, oh my God, they really need to give the viewer space here. You know, there's enough in the storyline without this big musical gesture, right? Now that's just a kind of, you know, that's a critical judgment. And I'm not saying it's the correct critical judgment. But it shows how, you know, intricate, right, the various parameters and decisions made by filmmakers and artists when they're kind of like aiming to elicit something as complex as an empathic reaction. It shows you how complex it is. You know, the pulling this lever, it's not as simple as pull this lever and it does the trick. You know, it's a whole set of things which come together in a kind of holistic way.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And we now have a question from Beres. Beres, please, can you ask your question?
Yeah, thanks. Well, I enjoyed both your talks very much. I'll just invite you, in closing, to think about what implications, if any, this would actually have to the value of cinema as an art form, actually, because to play devil's advocate for a moment, I mean, basically, one of Murray's points was that more than empathy is required for understanding other people. Okay, I think that's fairly widely accepted. And then Katalin brought out that high degrees of empathy actually make it quite easy to persuade people of various views. Okay, and we can also add the, I think, correct observation that successful films often aim at empathy, and perhaps even that cinema tends to be very good at achieving empathy. If you put all those together, you should come to the conclusion that successful films, it seems to me, can be cognitively dangerous, okay? Because they set you up to be potentially persuaded by all these false views that are smuggled in through empathizing with characters. And so you might say, you know, so much the worse for cinema as an art form, that it's got this incredible capacity which you know, experimental work has shown to persuade us in ways we shouldn't be. So is that a correct conclusion? And or more generally, what implications of this discussion has, do they have for, think about the value of cinema as an art form, if any?
Yeah, we should burn it to the ground, Ferris. That's
That's what I thought you were saying, Barry. Put yourself out of work.
Katalin, I have some thoughts, but do you want to? You've actually got your hand up, Katalin. Did you mean to have your hand up?
Oh, that was my previous. I can lower my hand. But what I can say that in the last 10 years, there was a positive turn in media psychology. So previously we talked a lot about the negative effects of narrative effects and violence and moral judgments, but recently there is a lot of investigation going on about the positive effects. And one of the line of research I really like is also related very much to this drive my car scene, that this movie does is that it kind of makes you exercise your empathic skills, because you constantly need to update the mental schema you have on the character's mental states. Oh, he's not perplexed, he knew it, so it's like a constant effort you have to make to negotiate and rethink what you think about the characters. And that's what could, like, a lot of the art house movies do with the viewers, that they playfully engage in an activity which is very useful for humanity, right? And that's what also research shows, also longitudinal research, that fictional narratives improve the skill, so can improve the skill or have a strong potential to improve empathic skills that we will start to use it more in real life as well. So that's the positive view on this issue.
So let me come in. I mean, I certainly kind of accord with what Katalin has just said about one virtue of I guess fictions in general, which would include filmic fictions in particular. But let me also make a kind of come at this in a separate way. I mean, a basic thought I would have is, you know, any powerful invention, right? So if we think of movie making as a kind of cultural invention, a technology even, right, can be used for good or ill. So just to make a quick parallel, I mean, you know, think of the mastery human beings have of food, and think of the vast quantities of bad food that are freely available and which many of us consume to our detriment every day. That doesn't erase the fact that there's lots of great food and lots of benefits we gain from having, you know, an elaborately developed and evolved food culture, right, around the world with different manifestations in different cultures. And so broadly, I would say the same about you know, an art form like film. There's no question that it can be used in bad ways, and it carries with it dangers, because anything powerful, but if you want to grant that something can be powerful in positive ways, it simply comes with that claim that those powers can be used to either deliberately or inadvertently, you know, in damaging ways. But I would also add this, that one of the things I was trying to emphasize at the very end of my talk is that I think there's a sort of folk idea around storytelling in general, movie making in particular, which puts huge and, in fact, misleading emphasis on the idea of empathy with a single character, right? You know, the sort of cliche that, you know, that film was wonderful because it just gave me that character's experience. I was there with the character, you know, I lived it. And that's usually a gross oversimplification of the complexity of the way in which we're brought in relationship to a central character, right? So when I was sort of saying at the end of the talk, well, actually, empathy is much more commonly part of a mosaic of responses where we need to talk about other things, whether it's in my kind of model where you make reference to sympathetic responses, or in Katalin's work, you'd make reference to those things like the parasocial dimensions, wishful identification, right? There was an array of other states which communication scientists invoke. The picture is usually more complicated than the kind of folk picture suggests. That doesn't necessarily mean that it's always a more positive picture, in the sense, Baris, that you were alluding to, but it does mean that it does mean there's good reason to kind of like not be quite so fearful that, as it were, the mass of filmmaking and moving image production is as straightforwardly bad for us as your nightmare vision suggests.
Good, yeah. Well, I mean, I was deliberately being provocative, of course, in order to raise this. But I mean, it seems, I mean, Greg Curry has a recent book, which you may have read, Imagining and Knowing. And he does actually precisely raise worries about the capacity of art in general, narrative art, to misinform. And given what you've both said about, you know, both the limits of empathy and the way that it actually can undermine our general understanding, I think in some ways that would be music to Greg's ears. And, you know, I guess the worry would be that, sure, to take Murray's technology analogy, yes, technology can be used in different ways, but maybe this is a bit more like military technology rather than food technology, i.e. it's kind of probably going to be used for bad purposes. It's got a bias built in that way. And again, that's rather provocative, but or to use the other analogy you use, that about the food analogy, the worry might be that most cinema is, as it were, junk cinema, like junk food, and it's tending to actually use empathy in order to persuade for various nefarious purposes. So that's perhaps a slightly more serious way of putting the worry.
Well, I mean, at one level, in a way, I'd probably accept that, right? But then I would say, well, it's not the job of as it were, cinema, you know, as a sort of particular institution or set of institutions to solve that problem. You know, the way I would see that is, we need to address the kind of Greg Curry style worry is a better understanding of, as it were, the role of the arts in the full scope, right, of the kind of institutions we have. So that would include science, right? And I suppose what I would, the point I would share, where I would kind of like share perhaps some part of Greg's project, is the thought that what we shouldn't be doing is kind of naively overvaluing the arts and what they can achieve relative to other kinds of education and achievement in life, right? And so that, I guess, impinges on us as educators, right? Not to be kind of like naively extolling the virtues of cinema and the other arts, not to be kind of confronting the potential kind of worries that you've been alluding to. So I don't think that the picture is as bleak as he thinks it is. And I know that you were doing it partly just for rhetorical purposes. But the thought I'm expressing now is that, to the extent that there is a problem, and I think he is getting at a real question, it goes beyond cinema. It comes to kind of like what it is to have a good liberal education. That's partly what I'm saying, which kind of like focuses on these kind of questions and tries to get them right.
Yeah, but I think it's important to acknowledge that this is the way narratives work. because there are studies in communication science that if you integrate misinformation into a narrative, people will believe it. So it goes against the notion of suspension of disbelief. It's the other way around. It's very difficult not to believe it if it comes with emotional engagement and identification and everything. You really have to make the viewer aware of the fact that this is not the truth, this is fake. And that's a known fact. And it's used and exploited in many areas, political communication, for example. So that's interesting, actually, to look at political talks, how much they are narrativized, right? Told as a narrative to make it more convincing.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, without wishing to turn this session into a kind of self-celebratory event, I mean, you know, to the extent that the kind of worries Beres is talking about are real, and they're certainly, I think, real in the sense that we need to inquire about them. Then it's precisely the kind of research that Katalin has just alluded to, which allows us to kind of get on top of those realities to the extent they are. You know.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much for your question and for both our speakers to give such an interesting discussion. I think this is a very good way of wrapping up our conversation, and perhaps you both showed us brilliantly that perhaps the integration and multidisciplinary research could actually be a way forward to address these issues. I would just like to remind our attendees that next week we will be back with talking about the use of disgust in art with Filippo Contesi and Valentin Wagner. So I would like to once again thank you very much our speakers for being here and everyone who attended this seminar. I'm gonna now stop the recording.
All right.